Hello, welcome. Hi guys, just waiting for everyone to join, just giving a few minutes. How are you, Michael, today? Good?
Yeah, I'm good. It's just been a long day.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right, so maybe we can just start with the introduction. Thank you guys for joining our webinar today. So my name is Antonella and I'm part of the admission team at Escape Studios. I specifically look after animation and character design and storyboarding courses and application at Escape. So then obviously if you have any curiosity or anything you would like to know, I'm happy to answer any question at the end during the Q&A. If you do have any question, please drop them in the Q&A button and then we will answer it at the end. So I'm here today with Michael Morgan. Hi, Michael, again. Who is a professional animator and is also our tutor for the part-time evening course, the 3D animation course. And he will give you a quick presentation also about his experience and about the job, the animator job, and what to expect from the industry also right now that has been impacted probably so from COVID and other particular circumstances. So, then obviously, if you have any question for him, feel free to ask us today. We are here and happy to answer any question you may have. And now we'll just pass it to Michael. So thank you. Enjoy.
Okay then. Thank you, Antonella.
You're welcome.
So I'm going to talk to you guys, just give you an intro on me, and then we'll go into talking about work in 2020. All right, so here we go. So let me share my screen and dive right in. Hopefully you guys can see this. One thing I need to just double check is you've got the sound as well. And here we go. My face on low. So yeah, so basically this is introduction talking about from the classroom to the studio. And what I mean by that is how we go from studies and how we get into the industry. So I'm going to talk about my journey quickly and then talk about animation industry. So I want to start off with showing you guys a little 1 minute video of a project that I worked on back in 2018. It's called Venom. And this is a sequence where about 7 or 8 animators worked on it. And the reason why I want to show you this is because it's a live action project, but all of this is fully CG. And we had the opportunity to work with the director in getting this sequence to actually be different and collaborate with the director in getting this onto the screen. So as previous, it was one way, but when it got to the studio and when it was starting to film and everything, they needed ideas in order to change it. So I just want to show you this and see how we, as animators, can sometimes get involved and collaborate with the director.
Rocket! No! We won't let you destroy this world! You die! strong host. They're not strong enough.
That's enough of that. Hopefully that's not too loud for you. But yeah, I wanted to show you that because a lot of the work that I do now is in that kind of realm where it's visual effects, it's film, but a lot of it is actually CG. So going back to the beginning, when I was smaller, I actually started out drawing. I did a lot of drawing, was very influenced by Looney Tunes, Warner Brothers, and stuff like that. So cartoons was a big thing for me. Saturday morning cartoons after school was always cartoons. And also me growing up in the 80s and 90s as a teenager, but mainly the 80s, a lot of the stuff that I was influenced by or inspired by was RoboCop, all these films here like Roger Rabbit, Batman. A lot of them, to be fair, I was young, so you know, I couldn't go to the cinema and watch them, but when we had VHS, I could watch a lot of these films before going to school. So Aliens, I probably was about 8, but I was able to watch it before going to school. And these are the things that influenced me a lot while I was growing up. So it's a lot of cartoons, a lot of drawing, a lot of films, things like that. All right. So as I was getting older, I went to uni, and at uni, because I did a lot of drawing, I wanted to pursue a career that was drawing based. But a lot of parents and adults, they would always say, there's no actual direction with drawing. You can't really get a career in drawing. So maybe you have to incorporate computers or something like that. So a lot of it was pushing me into the direction of, say, graphic design. So graphic design was something that I thought I could go into. And going to uni, I did graphic design, then I did multimedia design. And one of the modules there was 2D animation. And that's when I really found that I enjoyed animation. So at the age of around, say, 21, I really focused a lot in doing animation in 2D. But in 1999, when I graduated, a lot of the studios, say from Disney, DreamWorks, they actually stopped doing their 2D and everything they were putting their investment into 3D. So 3D animation from 1999 was something that a lot of these studios were now investing in and starting to put their energy. So for me, graduating with 2D skills, it was one of those situations where, now how can I take everything that I've been learning for the last 21 or 20 plus years, and now it's flipped on its head. So what do I do now? So basically, once I graduated, I had to teach myself 3D. So this slide here is basically the character that I was doing in my final year and trying to develop my 2D skills and create it and take it into 3D. Okay. So once I was able to go from graduating, going into 3D, it was a case of spending the summer just constantly in my house, just sorting out how can I adapt my skills to 3D, getting 3D Studio Max at the time, and just really going in there, doing modeling, doing rigging, doing animation, basically doing it all. Because back in 99, 2000, it wasn't the same as it is now. There wasn't any free online rigs. Well, there probably was one or two, but it wasn't the way it is now. So when I did finally get my opportunity in video, in the animation industry, it was in video games. And as you can see, it was the state of the art, next generation PS2. So what was nice about it was I actually, like I said, do a lot of drawing, like cartoons, films, but I also was addicted to video games. So while I was at uni, I was always playing Resident Evil, Tomb Raider, all the PS2 stuff. So to be able to work on the PS2 was a blessing. And Here I'll show you some next gen state-of-the-art 2000 animation graphics. So here, some of the characters I would have modeled, but all of it I would have animated. All right, so I'll just give you an example of my 2000 first animations. Boom, that's not it. Let's go back, press play. Here we go. So this was all done in 3D Studio Max. And if you guys know about it, it was through Character Studio. And like I said, the graphics right there are just state of the art. And these characters I would have made, rigged, modeled, and animated. So that's what I did back in my, like, my first jobs in video games. I was doing video games for 5 years. And then it was once I got to this project. So let me just show you here if I can pause this. On this project here, this was actually a video game called Robots, which we were working alongside a studio in New York or Connecticut at the time. And they were called Blue Sky. And they were working on a film called Robots. It was actually the second film after Ice Age. So they did a film called Ice Age, which was a CG animated feature. And then their next follow-up film was Robots. And this was like getting to work with Blue Sky as they were showing us all the behind the scenes stuff that they were doing for the film. We were then looking at that and trying to make it work for the video game. And seeing that, it actually put a shift in me where I thought, I want to do more than video games. I want to do more than just doing the cycles and the mechanics. I want to start doing things where I can start getting performance. And it was then that I saw what they were doing, that it could be maybe a possibility to adapt and grow even further and start doing character animation on that kind of level. So it was at that point that I wanted to advance and start doing acting. And then at that time, it was what, 2005? So like I said, 5 years into industry. 2005, there was an online course that I went on to, and that's where I was able to start doing acting and start doing performance and start really pushing animation. Because like I said at first, I was doing 2D, self-training to make that 2D into 3D transition. And then from there, 5 years later, to go on an online course where I could then really learn from the experts and get to do acting and all that kind of performance. Okay. So here's some amazing acting that you're going to see right now. So, you know, back then doing video games, I didn't have to film myself that much. So going in there and starting to film myself for my performance was very nerve-wracking. You get self-conscious, but nonetheless, we're going to show some early footage, okay? And there you go, mind blowing. So that was just me trying to get comfortable with the camera, trying to get comfortable doing some acting, which is not really anything big or sort of like that, but it's just getting the body mechanics and taking that then and adapting it to the 3D element, which was this character, which some of you guys might be familiar with, back in 2005. Boom. And adapting that to doing a test, taking the animation, or the live action, I should say, and then put it into an animation form, and then boom. All right. So that was the beginning of me trying to start getting into animation, getting into acting, and going into that character performance.
It's okay. No, it's not okay. It's definitely not okay. This is okay.
So this is me channeling to my female energy, trying to really go into more subtle kind of acting, more emotional, more cringe factor, but me really there trying to actually get into acting more. And then taking that, boom, boom, boom. and adapt it to the 3D character.
It's okay. It's okay.
No, Thelma, it's not okay. It's definitely not okay. None of this is okay.
So it's just taking everything, getting familiar or comfortable, should I say, being behind the video camera, being in front of the video camera, staging and getting emotions, all right? All this stuff you guys know already, but it was, for me, it was going from video games where a lot of it was just body mechanics and getting the character moving around the screen to now taking that and starting to get that performance where I'm getting to find out what's in the character's head, the emotions, all right?
It's okay.
So once I then took that work, started to develop myself, my skills on the course, once I graduated, I then actually went to the graduation, which was in California. And here I showed this slide because I went to the festival, the graduation, and it was at SIGGRAPH in San Diego. And I was able to go around and start talking to all these different studios and finding out what they were doing, finding out the different kinds of films, animated shows, video games, all under one roof. And it was there that I got to speak with Lucasfilm, which was there, LucasArts as well. Because I worked in video games, I could go with LucasArts. Because I was pushing to go into film, they had Lucasfilms. This was having everything under one roof, industrial arts, and industrial light and magic. All of this was all in under one roof. So when I went to talk with them, and I saw they were doing Transformers, the second Transformers actually at the time, I just thought to myself, it would be great if I could somehow get to work with these guys. I thought, me being from the UK, it wouldn't be that hard to get over to the States. Obviously, young, naive, didn't understand about visas at the time. But at that time, they were also talking about Singapore. So this was what, 2007, I was talking with them, and they were just setting up a studio in Singapore to actually start production on The Clone Wars. Now, I was thinking, yeah, California, that's where I want to go. And they were talking to me about Singapore. And I was like, well, I don't really know about animation that's being done in Singapore. So let's direct their attention to California. But as it was, I ended up getting called up for an opportunity to go to Singapore. And that's where I ended up being for the next 3 years. And this is a few guys that I worked with over in Singapore. So it was an amazing opportunity for me to, even though it was something that I wasn't actually thinking that I would go and do, like going to Singapore wasn't really on the radar. But as an opportunity came up, I took it, went there, and learned so much from being there. All right. So let me show you a bit of the Clone Wars work that we did, all that. This is the real 3 seasons. I worked, while I was there, I was at LucasArts, working on the video game section for a few months. And then I went into Lucasfilm, which is a TV department, doing the Clone Wars. All right. So I always cringe when I play all my old stuff, but here we go.
I must have blacked out.
Well, then who landed the shuttle?
General, you have to stop this. This is unfair to the cadets.
Battle positions, everyone!
They're not interested in us, but still, we can't just wander around aimlessly. We need a plan.
You always taught me to go on instinct, and my instincts taught me to go that way.
that's so old school. That's like 10 years ago. So yeah, so going from Singapore, coming back to the UK. And as you can see here, these are a few shows that I worked on after. But what happened was I went from full CG production to then working in visual effects. Going into London, trying to adapt from, like I was saying, from full CG, I found that London was a lot, there was a lot of actual visual effects work. So it was more, can you now do creature work? Because what I found was all the work that I did before was a lot of character based. When I was going to studios in London, they were telling me that a lot of my stuff's too cartoony. So I had to try to adapt. And in that, I then, as I was doing before, I took on a course so I could actually start looking and start breaking down creature work, quadrupeds, and things like that. Let me just quickly jump onto this. And I can see you guys got some questions. So let's see if I can answer. All right. Maybe they're not real. They're just, you guys are making comments. Okay, cool. So yeah, so with that being said, as you can see, Clone Wars, and then I worked on Tree Fruit Tom. So Clone Wars is all very CG, very action-packed, very lightsabers and everything like that. Then I jumped onto Tree Fruit Tom, which was very zany kind of cartoony animation. And then from Tree Fruit Tom, I made a jump over to the Lone Ranger. Now, even when I look at this, these projects, I think, how did I go from Tree Fruit Tom to Lone Ranger? I actually watched Lone Ranger the other day. It's better than I remember. So worked on the Lone Ranger, and let's see, I think the next slide, I can show you a clip, the sequence that we worked on the Lone Ranger. About 5-6 animators, we worked on a sequence. So let me bring that up and you guys can see. Actually, before I'll show you that, what I wanted to do was make sure that I could go from character to creature. So like I said, I had to study a lot of creature work, and I worked on a course or doing creature work. So here's an example of my first real try at doing quadrupeds. So a lot of the stuff that I'm throwing on here are me showing you my first attempts, me pushing and going, all right, I've never done quadrupeds before, so let me have a stab in trying that. Here we go. So this was getting a cat and just so you know, and then going from that to not just trying to do quadrupeds, but trying to do creatures that had wings, working on live action plates. It was, for me, I was always a person, I still am, a person that knows that, all right, if I want to get into film, if I want to get into this department, I've got to go out there and at least try, show and prove to myself that I can do it. So at least I can push to get on those projects. And when I'm on the project, I know I can deliver. So this, after doing the cat animations and doing quadrupeds, I then tried to start work with heavy creatures with wings, working on live action plates. So this is one of my early tests that I worked on as well. So this was working, like I said, with a live action plate and just really researching how these creatures would work. Now, if I look at it and think it's pretty old, and I could see, yeah, I could add weight to this, I could do this, I could do that. But it was always about me going out there and trying to learn this stuff before I get a project or before I could get onto these projects and shows. And then here's what I was wanting to show you. So when I finally did get from, say, Tree Fruit Tom, which is full CG, I worked with a team on the Lone Ranger, and this is the sequence that I worked on with them. Like I said, about 5-6 animators. So a small team, which was nice for my first time doing visual effects. And this is what we did. That's all right. Press play.
This is worse.
Nature is most definitely
out of balance. Hello again. Any chance you could...
So yeah, I don't know if you guys could see what we'd actually did, but for that, we did the scorpion, so I'll ask you guys later because I can't really do back and forth, but let me know if you thought those scorpions were real or fake. And here we go. So this is what I do now. This is real that I have that's showing basically a lot of the work that I do film is characters, creatures, and visual effects. So I'll just play the reel and jump. Boom. Keep pressing the wrong button.
Him. Any chance you could...
Shiny blue suitcase, Ark of the Covenant, Maltese Falcon sort of vibe. What is it?
I am Groot.
So what? What's the order?
I have no words for an honorless thief.
Get out of here.
Nine! To a snake!
And that project there was when I went to Germany. And worked on a project called Pettersson and Findus. So that's basically me going from drawing, getting into the industry, and how my journey was going from video games to TV to film. And the reason why I show you that and play it out like that as well is because I just want you guys to see that just because you get into the animation industry, it doesn't need to be one thing. You don't just get into games and games only or film or TV. You're able to move around depending on what you want to do. And when I talk about that, I also want to show you this in a case of, all right, so that was me, what, 2000 to 2020. So with this whole thing of 2020, is the industry still now in a good place? Is it still, like, would animation be something you want to get into? Is it something that's moving forward, or has it had its time? All right, it might sound a bit silly, but a lot of us know that this year has been a year where things have been very disruptive. So I show you this slide because, yes, back in the days of where it says here, Harry Potter, the UK especially, and I'm mainly focused on the UK because that's where we're based, in Britain, in London, Manchester, Sheffield, all over the UK. It's not just London. Sometimes people think the UK is only London. But it's one of those things of there is still a lot of work going on. And the industry, is animation industry healthy? In many ways, it is. Okay, so the visual effects side of it, obviously visual effects requires filming. So filming, that part is quite in the whole social distancing. Can we have filming happening? So those things get put on pause. Okay, everything gets put on hold. But like I showed you at the beginning, working on Venom, that was a live action film with CG elements. So the whole of that last sequence was all CG. So that doesn't require filming. It's just you go from previs, pre-production, you get it sorted out with the director and everybody, but it's all in CG. And then in post, it's all in CG. So those kind of works can be done without filming, without the need for actual doing shoots. All right, so that's why I say the industry still is healthy. And then not just VFX, but as an animator, you can go, like I said, into video game, you can do cinematics, anything that's CG or even 2D, it allows you to be an animator. All right, so with this slide, you guys know you're on lockdown and you got Disney Plus, whether you subscribe or not. And then most of us have got Netflix. So with that being said, there's a lot of shows, a lot of the film stuff has gone to TV, and the level of quality of TV is coming up to the same as film. So you can watch a TV show on Netflix, say like Stranger Things, and look at the quality of that, look at the creature animation on that, and you can see that that kind of work is of a high level. Then you're looking at Disney where they're pushing, they've got Mandalorian, and they've not only got that, but they've also got shows where they're doing the Marvel shows. And not only that, full CG projects. So in terms of animation, it's going to keep pushing, it's keep going. It's something that is a healthy industry to get into, all right? So that's what I want to say on that level. But as an animator who's in it on a day-to-day, how does that affect you? Well, you got to be able to work from home. Okay, so everything that we do is digital. So in that sense, working from home, and you guys watch Boris every day with it, the different kinds of situation, 6 people in your house or social distancing, go to work, don't go to work, work from home. All these different things, well, for us as animators, artists that work on digital, we can actually work from home. It's sometimes not ideal. Obviously, it's a situation where this has all happened very quickly, but a lot of studios that you'll talk to have adapted everything so you can work with VPNs and you can work as long as you've got your setup, your workstation or laptop at home, which is what you want to make sure you have as an animator, artist in this industry. You want to make sure you've got your workstation because as you can see, when I was talking about my journey, every time even from uni, when I graduated, I had to have my own workstation to do my own work. Back in those days, I was working in JD Sports during the day and working on my own stuff at night. And that hasn't really changed in a sense of you always need to be in a situation where if you need to do your own work, your own projects, your own little tests, whatever you want to do, you want to have your workstation at home. I'm not saying that you get into the industry and you got to still do loads of work at home, but you want to be able to know that you can juggle it, you can balance it, that if you want to do your little ideas and personal work, you've got a setup, you've got a laptop, you've got a workstation, you've got something that you can do at home. Just hearing the neighbors going crazy. But it's one of those kind of things where you want to always make sure you can do personal work, all right? That's what I say, and that's what I personally believe. So with that kind of thing going on, that mentality, thinking, all right, I want to push myself. I've got my setup at home. then that makes you ready for certain things like this. So this disruption that's happening, you've got to set up at home that you can always jump on. All right, that's my little thing there. Jump to the next stage. So in order to go forward and make sure that you're not only ready for the work at home and everything like that, you've got your animation skills and you're building that. You want to make sure that you've got your skills on one hand and you're also building your network. Because when you're in this industry, you need to be able to talk with people. You need to be able to know what's going on in the industry. And the only way you're really going to know is by talking to other people. So whether it's your colleagues at uni, college, or at events. Now this, I recommend a lot of you guys go to these events. And especially when you think to yourself, all right, 2020, a lot of events have been canceled, but they're not actually canceled. Some are postponed and pushed back. Some are all virtual or online. But the case, what I'm trying to say here is make sure that you're always tapping in and finding out what's going on in the animation scene, whether it's where Animex says it's VFX, it's games, it's animation. It's just making yourself aware of what's happening in the industry, okay? And festivals are a great way of doing that because the people that talk at those festivals, they're approachable. They're someone that, you know, they're people that you can talk to and find out what's going on. So if you want to get into films, you've got people that you can talk to. If you want to get into games, there's people to talk to, all right? So even if you're in the industry already, you don't have to give up and go, all right, I'm in the industry and I know it all already. You still want to be going to these festivals. You still want to surround yourself and absorb all this kind of stuff that's animation-based, okay? And that's what helps you constantly. The reason why I say this is because I'm always dipping in and finding out what's going on in the animation industry, and it helps me to always know where the next job is or the next project. And it's not just because, all right, so I work in this industry and I work within these four walls. If I do that and stay narrow and stay in my own bubble, then I won't find out what's going on. So you've always got to make sure you're always, you know, going out there and checking out what's happening in the animation industry as a whole. And with that being said, I'm going to show you guys a project I worked on, the Black Panther. And this was a sequence that we worked on, a small team again. And it was with the Black Panther and Killmonger.
Shuri! Turn on the train on the bottom track.
The stabilizers won't activate your suit. You won't have protection.
Neither will he.
Okay.
Okay, and with that being said, I'm going to end it there and we can have a Q&A and take you back over to Antonella. Boom. All right, Antonella, you there?
Yep.
All right.
That was very interesting.
Cool.
So I think... So we have already some questions, so we'll just read some of them random. I guess they're mainly for you, but just, so let's see. Okay, so there is an anonymous attendee who asks, if it does apply, so were there times when you saw improvements in your work or moments when things clicked a little bit more for you? Maybe something you add to your workflow or some exercise you started doing. So any specific tips or things that you start doing or that were shown?
any specific tips or let me see if I can understand that question. So for me, a lot of things clicked when, but they take a long time to click really, because, so for instance, if I talk about acting, when I was first doing acting, so some of the acting shots that I did initially, there will be a lot of hands moving around, a lot of hand gestures, and I'll be looking at things like Jim Carrey acting or, how can I say, Beetlejuice, Nicolas Cage, all this kind of where the acting is very hands-based. And then you start to realize really solid acting, they don't have to use all of this, you know, these gestures and start putting, you know, I'm putting my hands in the air like crazy. But those kind of things clicked later on, where to look at solid acting, what makes strong acting and things like that, what makes strong performances. So those different, you constantly got to keep practicing to start understanding this makes a strong performance, this doesn't, this feels very generic. You know, back in the days, you see all a lot of acting choices that people were making, which were very similar to another animators. And then you start getting copies of copies. And that's when I started realizing you want to look at even old silent movies, or you might look at films like Citizen Kane, or you're looking at films from the Coen Brothers. You start to see this different type of acting, very subtle, very emotional. And you start to think, how can I adapt that to animation? All right. Yeah. I'm not sure I even got the question right, but it's just those are the kind of things that click. You start to realize there's not one kind of acting.
I think it's very helpful.
So, yeah. All right.
Then with 3D animation demo reels, if you saw two reels, who would you be more likely to get a job in a studio? Someone with a highly polished reel, or someone who shows more character and appeal in their work, but maybe doesn't have so highly polished reel?
Yeah, I think it obviously depends on the animation supervisor and the team. But the way I see it is you can learn that polish. So as long as you've got, I guess, the ideas and the feel for animation, because obviously everything I say is subjective. It's something that I feel and someone else might say otherwise. But I do feel that polish is something you learn, whereas the ideas and the creativity, that is something that is more in demand. So I would say out of the two reels, and this is tricky because some people do just go, all right, then that's polished, that works. We can just fit them into the production. And this person's got ideas and creativity, but at the same time, we just need them just to just polish work. We don't need them to have so much creativity. So it actually depends on the project that you're going into. All right. So there's no one shoe fits all. That's my way of getting around it.
Right. And then someone else is asking, so is there an indirect pathway for a 3D animator to get in a studio? So something like maybe starting with a production assistant job first, and then maybe you can move to a different direction, for example.
Yeah, you can do that, but you have to be careful that you don't get stuck. And what I mean by that is, so when I started out, like I show my journey, but obviously I'm not going to talk 20 years of journey in, you know, I try and break it down into 20, 30 minutes. And my first job was actually, after graduating, was in motion capture data analysis. So that was the person that's joining the dots together in motion capture. And I don't want to talk about that because it's one of those things of, I was working on it for 3 months while at the same time trying to do my own thing at night, working on modeling. But you don't have to go directly. So what I'm trying to say there is you don't have to be an animator from the start. You can go in, like you said, as production, but you got to make sure that you're at some point going to make yourself come out of that. Because if you go into one role. I think the neighbors are killing their children, but you can go in one direction, but you've got to make sure that you've got your way of getting out. So if you're working during the day as a production, you got to work hard at night, you know, burn the candle at both ends in order to be producing animation work that you then can show to your team and see if a supervisor or someone will get you on in the animation role. It's a hard one to do, but it's something that you want. If you really want to do it, you got to push to get that happening. All right?
Yeah, got it. And what has been the hardest movie you ever work on?
The hardest one. They're all hard in their own way. So, because some shots, you think they should be straightforward and then they give you headaches. So, but not the hardest, but one of the, I don't know if I've got it on that list, is The Martian.
Okay.
It's the movie that let me know that I don't want to do any spaceships or, you know, rotating Mars. Strictly characters and creatures is something that I prefer. So you can go on some projects and you realize that as an animator, there are things that you gravitate to more and some things that you gravitate to less. So for me, it's not the hardest, but it's the, should I say,
yeah,
the most boringest. So yeah, Martian.
Hannah, how long does a shot take you to do?
Shot can take, especially, I see Steve's on here, Steve Hawthorne. So Steve actually worked with me on Venom. So the first sequence you see, one of the shots in there was one of Steve's. So, or two actually. We can take a week to block, then a week to final. You know, it could go from that. Or you could be on a shot for 3 months, literally. So it's that range. And the shot could be from 3 seconds, 10 seconds. It just depends on the production, how long the shots can take, and how complex they are as well. And when I say a shot takes, say, a month or two, you won't be on that shot every single day. You will have other shots in between. So you might be on that for a few weeks, then come off it and come back to it. And there's a lot of iterations.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah. And so then let's see something else. So did your workflow change between working on full CGI TV series to working like on live action films?
Yeah. So my workflow, when I started in video games, my workflow was always Sublime because I worked in Max. And then when I did the online course, Animation Mentor, a lot of that was, they showed a step mode. And that was the first time I did stuff in step mode. It was actually the first time I worked in Maya. So I worked, my first 5 years was in Studio Max. And so 5 years in working on Maya and then learning the graph editor. The graph editor was a headache. So that was horrible. But after a while you get used to these things. And yeah, so I started using Stepped. And then once I got into visual effects, I no longer use Stepped. I just go back to how I did in games. I use in Spline. Mm. Because when I was using Stepped on live action plates, it was kind of hard for me to see stuff. So I'll do stuff in Spline. And if some of the directors or supervisors or whoever, they want to see it blocked, but they want it in Stepped, you can just change it from Spline, go in the graph editor and change it to Step mode. So there's always a way. So for me, in the time that I've been doing this stuff, it's constantly changing and adapting the workflow to work for whatever project it is. So to be fair though, I found when I was working on Treat Food Tom, step mode was brilliant because TV, working pose to pose, step works. But working in film, Sublime is easier for me. So yeah, the workflow changes depending on what's the project or what's the show or whatever.
Do you think it's also subjective?
Yeah, it's all subjective. It's all whatever feels right for you. You might want to do it in steps or you might want to do it in spline. It just depends. Like some people will tell you you have to do it in this method, but I think, you know, we always change. You know, it's like cooking chicken. You might grill it, you might bake it, whatever, fry it.
Right. Did you know all the languages you did lip sync for if it wasn't English?
Oh, yeah. So when I went to Germany, I'm not going to speak German now, but I was studying German for the 6 months that I was there. But we didn't really need to know the language. It's because as long as you could get the mouth shapes and that was at Pixelmondo. So what one team was working on Game of Thrones, another team of us were working on this little cat character with a, it was good. It was, we didn't need to learn German, but it helped.
Okay, that's interesting. And how do you see the development on face capture and motion capture?
So yeah, when I was working on apes, you could see that the face capture is obviously state of the art. It's amazing, basically, that's all I can say. So a lot of the projects now, there's a lot of face capture that's happening.
Yeah.
But we still need to do a lot of work on top of that. So no matter how well the stuff is captured, to put it onto the 3D rig, you still need to understand animation. You still need to understand how to tweak what you're looking at and make it feel believable for that character. So for apes, and this is the thing as well with the way they work on apes, is they'll have a team that works on the face alone. So they're day in, day out. Yeah, night and day, just doing facial animation and they're understanding all the brows, the cheeks, everything. And as an animator, that's what we, you know, you have to get into that level of detail. So face capture is, impressive.
What is your take on diversity in the UK animation industry? Do you see changing it for the better?
Diversity, I don't know. In the UK, I'm gonna say, I don't know. Because okay. I don't really see that much diversity in that sense, to be honest. It's balanced, but it could be better. It could be a lot better, yeah.
All right. And what should be the first step to start into visual effects industry?
The first step is talk to you, Antonella. That's what's the first step. Now, the first step would be just really have an interest. Like a lot of the things are you interested in visual effects? Are you interested in film? Are you interested in special effects? It's having that interest, because sometimes people just, they pick up something because it's the trend. And sometimes you got to think to yourself, and you know, some people tell you.
Yeah, what I personally notice is that sometimes, for example, also for students, they are very interested like in visual effects, but they don't know the difference probably, or they don't know the pipeline. So they don't know actually what they enjoy doing in a kind of way. So probably as you have more experience, I guess that the type of question is more like, how do you know where do you want to go in the visual effects?
All right. So with that being said, the thing with me is I'm a person that goes to the buffet and then I find out which food I like and then I'll have more of that. So it's one of those things of, with visual effects, if you feel like it's that broad, then you're going to have to go and figure it out. I can't tell you, because for me, I never actually wanted to just go into visual effects. My thing is animation. So I'm quite focused on animation, whether animation fits into visual effects, if it fits into games, TV, or whatever. my sole desire is animation. So to call it visual effects, you'd never see me go and say, I want to be an effects artist, because that doesn't really touch on my, I can't even speak English today, but it doesn't really, it doesn't float my boat. Do you know what I mean? It doesn't yeah. call to me. So with that being said, I break it down. For instance, when I started with this whole thing, because I draw, drawing was my main purpose, my main motivator. So if I couldn't do drawing in animation, it became the 3D animation side of it. So that was modeling, but rigging, I can't stand rigging. So I don't want to do rigging. I know I want to model. Rigging, I don't like. Animation, I do like. So how do I get around that? I'll just jump over to animation. So I found which areas that I enjoy and which ones I didn't. You know, lighting, I'm not interested in lighting. Cameras are all right because it helps you with story. So I kind of organically you start to figure out, I like this, I don't like that. You know, you start to mix and match. So when you're asking about visual effects, you got to ask yourself, do I like the effects? Do I want to be someone who blows things up? Do I want to be someone who makes a water simulation? Am I someone who likes lighting, making cars, making creatures and stuff like that? Do I like fur? So you start to figure out, yeah, this is what I like. You don't have to go out there and actually example or sample every one of those, but you know within yourself that these are the three things or five things that I'm interested in, so I might just try them out. Does that make any sense? Or am I just going?
I got it. Hopefully also the audience got it.
All right.
And so how easy is to get a job abroad? In terms of job acceptance, what are some of the countries where 3D jobs are widely available?
Okay, so is it easy to get a job? No, it's not easy to get a job. You've got to make sure that, all right, so in this sense, like I was saying before, you've got to have skills, and that's the foundation. And does it have to be polished? Does it have to be perfect? No, it doesn't have to be polished or perfect, but you have to show competence, have to show that you have a good level of understanding for animation. Then you have to look at, I guess, what country you're in. So if we're based in Europe, you know, there's a lot of animated projects out there in France. The UK's got a lot of visual effects, a lot of animated shows as well. But then you might think of the time period in 2020. Can I actually even go abroad? So that makes it more difficult. And you think to yourself, how can I find work in this kind of climate? Is it easy? And the answer is, it's not easy, but it's not impossible. It's like what I was saying before. It's going on those networks and finding out what's happening. Because there was a point, say when March hit, and a lot of us had work, say, contracted out for the rest of the year. And then studios might have had projects that they had to put on hold or cancel. So then you're out of work. So June, July, you're out of work. So then you've got to think to yourself, how am I going to find work? Everybody's all been let go. It's going to feel like it's impossible. But when you're connected with all these different people, you can start finding out that actually there's a job over here in the UK, or I'm not going to always talk about Canada because Canada has a lot of work, but we're not Canadians. So I'm going to focus on us being in the UK or being in Europe, that you'll find that there is work out there, but you just got to find yourself having a bigger network, basically. That's what I'm trying to say. So going to those festivals, going online, you start to realize there's work in Spain, Italy, and all these different places. Like, for instance, you've got Germany. I went to Germany and worked at Pixamondo on the Pettersson Finders, but I never knew it even existed. I didn't even know about the project. But because I was talking with people in one social gathering, mm. one of the guys said, we've got work. We're looking for animators on this show in Frankfurt. Now, it's only because I was in that environment, talking with those people, that I was then able to know about the job. It wasn't on a billboard. It wasn't on a job posting. It wasn't on all these things or on a website. It was because I'm talking to people. It's because I'm at festivals. It's that kind of thing, you know.
Yeah.
You've got to be around people and open up your network so you can find out what's going on. Okay?
Totally. And now that everyone is working from home, are studios still as keen to take on entry-level animators, or are they looking for more senior animators? How can graduates get into the industry working from home? So what do you think is the request right now, and how is the industry changing?
So that's one that's pretty hard as well, because
yeah.
So studios are going to start seeing that hiring entry level is pretty hard for them at this current stage, because they need to be able to, like, how can I say, you don't get as much face time, you don't get much hands on with these people. So it's a case of, as a senior, they can just say, get this done, we'll see you at dailies at whatever time, and they will get, you'll get stuff done. With a junior, they need more hands on. So it's not to say that they won't have any junior entry level jobs, but it's a case of studios will have to think carefully and go, once we get junior level jobs going, we've got to invest our time to help these students or help these graduates, to help these entry level. And the studio has to really invest the time and energy. So I'm not saying that it's impossible, because I've seen jobs that are looking now for entry level. Okay, so it is happening. But the only difference now is it's a big demand on the student, the graduate, the entry level artist. They have to be more than just an artist. They have to somehow be showing initiative, show that they can, you know, this is going to be your first time on a project, but you got to start thinking, well, what do I need to do? How can I think beyond just doing what I've been told? For example, let me just try and give you an example. I worked in Montreal on Artemis Fowl. So we had a few juniors, but I was physically there. Mm. And you have to put so much energy in that if you transfer that now onto online, you got to think to yourself, how can I make sure that this artist is getting the best out of my time, and I'm giving them the best and the most amount of feedback and helping them, basically, so they don't just fizzle out and just get left on their own and not able to work. Trying to make sense here. But because when you're working from home, you're uh-huh. actually left alone quite a lot, okay? So that's the thing that I'm trying to get at, is there is work, but you have to start realizing that a lot of these studios are now got this whole expectation of, we give you the work, we get back to you in 3 or 4 hours, we want to see what you've done. Whereas in the studio, you've got your colleagues that you can talk to, and you can have that back and forth.
Mm.
You can do the same online, but it's going to be like, can you Google chat with someone and ask them questions and try and have that communication going? But it's making and having that initiative to do that, mm. because it's not set up like that. You have to have the initiative. So if you're entry level and you come on board, you've got to think to yourself, okay, then let me talk to my team. Let me talk to people. Just don't suffer in silence, basically, because it's too easy now that we work from home to suffer and sit in silence and go, oh my gosh, I don't know how to do this. And then the day goes by, you haven't got anything for the next day because you didn't contact anyone to talk to them.
Yeah.
That make
communication
any sense,
is always the key anyway.
Yes, communication is the key. So even answering, are there entry-level jobs? Yeah, there is. That's the long way of saying it. Yeah, there is.
Okay. And then let's see. So what are your favorite two plug-in script for human animation?
So to be fair, I actually don't use many scripts, but I do like AnimBot. And the only thing I like about a lot of these are just like Studio Library and stuff like that. I just like AnimBot, just to copy animation. So yeah, that's it.
Okay, so maybe just the last one, guys, because it's already quite late. Let's see. So such an interesting presentation, thank you. I have a question. Do you think it is important nowadays to learn about real-time technologies for animation, especially Unreal, that seems to be gaining a lot of interest in animation and visual effects? Yes.
Yeah, definitely. I feel like as artists, it's always good to grow. Like the thing is, it's one of those things of, we can keep growing, we can keep learning, we can keep learning to the point that we're not specializing. We're just going all over the place. But I do feel the industry is pushing real time, especially Unreal Engine. I'm seeing a lot that's happening with that. That looks really great. So I would definitely say spend your time and yeah, explore the Unreal Engine.
And what software would you recommend for beginners to start with?
So for me, I would say Maya, but I know Blender is doing a lot right now. Mm. So
yeah, Blender is coming back.
Yeah, Blender's coming back. So I know a lot of productions use Maya. I also know, to be fair, I'm one of those people that was started out with Max. We had Softimage. We had, I don't even know if Maya was actually called Maya back then. But what I'm trying to say is the software is the software. I was about to say software doesn't matter, but I do not want to ever touch 3D Studio Max again, because when I look at it, I don't know where the buttons are. So sometimes, you know, depending on which software you use, it's not so easy to jump onto the next. So I'm just going to say Maya or Blender. Those are the two. Try and find what's being used in the industry and use those. But I do know there's a big Blender community and there's a big Maya community. So those two I would say for animation.
So, okay, I will try the last one, trying to condensate. So have you ever felt burnout from overworking? So how did you get through it? And how do you balance kind of your scheduling, studies and work?
Burnout's, how do I get over it? I am asleep. Burnout is one of those things that you really want to check. And the way to avoid that is literally, just look at balancing. These are just words, I guess. But yeah, definitely make sure that you're not just 24/7 in front of that machine, because your eyes, I've worked so much that my eyes just feel like they're bleeding. You know, they're just, so that's not great. And just listen to your body, basically. If you really do feel that destroyed, then step away from it and just go outside. Not obviously at midnight, but just go out. Actually, if you want to do some midnight marauding, go outside and just get some fresh air. But make sure you balance it in that sense of not just sitting in front of the machine, because it doesn't benefit you. If your health declines, you know, it's you can't do this for a long time. Then you got to make sure that you literally are looking after your health and not just sitting in front of your machine every day all day. Like, granted, to be fair, I do spend a lot of time in front of the machine, but because I got my family, they will drag me away. So, you know, if you got someone out there who's in your house with you who would drag you away, then that's a good thing. If you don't and you live on your own, then you have to be disciplined enough to to get away and just say, all right, I'll walk around the block. Even with this whole lockdown, you know, I'll get out, do some fresh air, go to Sainsbury's, interact with someone, social distance.
Yeah, I think it's the same for everyone. Kind of finding some time for yourself.
Definitely.
Well, so I think that we are already a bit late, so it's already, I kept you quite a lot. So sorry, guys, if we haven't finished all your questions for Michael. But obviously, if you have anything else you want to know, also if you're curious about the courses, the next intake, or anything else, or if you need a piece of advice, feel free to drop us an email. Also have a look at our website, the Escape Hub. You can find a lot of online events and online resources, very useful, that and events also that we are running right now. So that's it, I guess. And thank you, Michael, for joining me today and hosting this webinar. It's been very, very interesting. And thank you.
Okay, then, cool. But I just quickly read something about teammates and stuff.
Do you want to
I'll quickly answer that. You definitely need to make sure you have a good connection with your teammates, with your colleagues, and with your friends from school, uni, because in this industry, the people you know help you grow, basically. Okay, so when I say networking, it's not just about finding this person, that person. It's about building a solid community of colleagues, people that can vouch for you, people that you can vouch for. It's that kind of thing. All right. So that's what I want to just end on that note. All right. Hopefully that helps.
Yeah.
And on that, Kate, I'm out.
Cool.
All right. Thank you very much, guys.
And, well, feel free to get in touch if you need anything else. Thank you, Michael. Yeah. Have a nice day.
Thank you. All right, then.
See you. Bye.
Bye.